up in the morning and out to school. The teacher is teaching the golden rule. American history and practical math. You study them hard and hoping to pass.
Hello and welcome to the East Ramapo Underground. This is Peggy Hatton. And Antonio Luciano is on special assignment for East Ramapo Underground. Are you there, Tony?
Yes, Peggy, I'm here. And, you know, it's good that everybody knows that you're in the studio and I'm out in the field on a special assignment. And I don't know if we should tell people what I'm actually doing.
I think you have to tell them where you are. Come on, Tony. Where in the world is Tony Luciano?
Well, I can't tell you exactly where I am because right now I'm hot on the trail of our missing board member, Mariluz Corrado, and I can't give my exact location. But I will say this past week I visited Bolivia, Chile, and Argentina, and I did find Carmen Sandiego in Bolivia, and I did find Waldo in Argentina. And I will leave no stone unturned, and I'm not coming back until I find Mariluz Corrado.
Oh, I think you better not make that promise. We need you back whether you find her or not, Tony. Have you met up with Dora the Explorer and Swipe or No Swiping yet?
No, I haven't run into them, but I will expect that I should run into them soon.
Well, maybe the Swipe or No Swiping can come back and save our tax dollars from being misspent in the East Ramapo School District. So Swiper, No Swiping. So with that, I think that we have a really action-packed show. As you know, there's a lot that's happened in East Ramapo since last month.
That's an understatement, Peggy.
Uh-huh. So I think that, you know, as a precursor, let me just say there's going to be some new rules today that we haven't had to put in the past. Today, we will not be accepting phone calls from bullies or haters. You know who you are. Don't bother calling in today. You will not be on the air. We've had our fill of that behavior. The Hero and Zero segment will be a little bit longer than usual because there is just so much to talk about. And then we'll be opening up the studio lines, and the number to call in is 362-0013. Okay.
Well, let's get on to those heroes and zeros, Peggy.
Okie doke. So, as many of you know by the media blitz that ensued, Board of Education lawyer Chris Kirby started laughing at me at a board meeting as I spoke about concerns of about my own child and other children in the district. Mr. Kirby saw it fit to smirk and laugh at me. He interrupted me while I was speaking and was totally out of control. Tony Luciano was the only man in the room who stood up for me, but more about that in just a minute. The heroes of the month. The heroes of the month are the people from all over Rockland County who stood with the East Ramapo community against the outrageous behavior of Chris Kirby, the Board of Education lawyer. More about him later. Also, we want to include as heroes of the month our state officials, Ellen Jaffe, Ken Zabrowski, and David Carlucci, and all of the other politicians and candidates who are running for office who came to attend the rally and the meeting to decide what was going to happen with the law firm representing East Ramapo. A little bit of a departure here. Trustee Rothman gets a half a hero for at least trying to stop Kirby from his continuing outrageous behavior in the parking lot. Mr. Rothman is the only trustee who apologized to me for the abuse that I suffered by Mr. Kirby. But more about that in the zero department just in a minute. There's also a new category of heroes this month because of what has gone on. It's going to be called the Retroactive Hero Award. And that Retroactive Hero Award goes to Steve Price, Suzanne Young Mercer, Mimi Calhoun, Ira Alstatcher, and Joe Farmer for trying to stop in November 18th, 2009, the hiring of the Manerva D'Agostino law firm that was done at 2:30 in the morning. They fought and lost a valiant fight that night into the wee hours of the morning, knowing the damage that would ultimately befall our district. So those are the heroes. Tony, hit it. Okay, now for the zero of the year. Goes to...
It's the month.
No, this is the Hero of the Year Award. It is going to go to Board of Education lawyer Chris Kirby. Kirby gets the trifecta for spewing forth sexual harassment, homophobic slurs, and religious epithets aimed primarily at Tony and I. Kirby's out-of-control behavior and vile behavior has no place in civil society, and I sure hope he gets the help that he needs. So hit it, Tony. Okay. And the other very deserving zeros are trustees and mayoral candidate for Spring Valley, Bernard Charles, and trustee Pierre Germain. Although these men profess that they are public school representatives, both men sat silently by as I was disrespected by Mr. Kirby inside the boardroom, not even flinching as I was being laughed at and taunted. They truly failed the litmus test for advocating and caring about my son's issues or other public school students' issues. President Weissmandel, Vice President Rothman, Trustee Solomon, and Hopstein failed to utter the three simple words that could have prevented the entire fiasco. Those words are, out of order. At one point, Dr. Klein himself started grinning as Kirby was taunting me as I spoke. I cannot think of another superintendent that would stand by letting such abuse take place. There has been no apology from any of these men, and I guess I won't be holding my breath waiting for that to happen. I guess being in positions of power in East Ramapo means never having to say you're sorry. A very poor example for our students. And go ahead, you can hit that boo there, Tony. Sound effects. Okay. And the final is a retroactive zero award that goes to then Vice President of the Board, Aaron Weeder, for imposing his will to hire Manerva and D'Agostino, saying that there would not be an increase in legal fees despite the more than double hourly rate of the council. Dr. Alstatcher predicted an increase from the budget that was $335,000 that would rocket to over $600,000 a year, and Dr. Alstatcher had it precisely right. So that's the last zero of the month. Okay, Tony, you want to chime in?
I'm really glad the boos are over because my finger was getting sore pressing that button.
I know. It's tough work.
But, you know, Peggy, besides that, there were a couple of things that happened in the month that I want to cover before we get on to the bigger issue of, you know, the profanity-laced tirade that happened. First of all was the budget revote. And here again, people in the East Ramapo are duped. You know, the powers that be in the yeshiva community passively let the budget pass a second time. And the budget no votes were down 59%. And here we have, as you remember last year, Peggy, in September when the Journal News ran their article, the former board president, Morris Cohn, said that the rabbis control the district, that the board goes to the rabbis whenever there's an issue or matter that needs to be resolved. Mm-hmm. And they're the ones that control whether people come out to vote no for the budget or not. And here they had, you know, passively let the budget pass again.
It's not the first time either that that's happened. I think it might be the third time. So
Actually, it's the sixth time.
The sixth time, okay.
You know, and each budget revote, Kathy Russell has mentioned, cost the district an extra $50,000.
And, you know, with that $50,000, you could hire two teaching aides for kindergarten for the entire year. So it's a waste of taxpayers' money. But the real issue is that they vote no. They tell people to vote no on the budget the first time around. When I say they, I mean the rabbis. And that's to get their particular candidates into office. And then they they don't tell them anything, or they tell them to vote no when they come out the second time. So I think we really are tired of that in East Ramapo, and I think that that's what precipitated a lot of people saying enough with the games, and a lot of our own people, including you, Tony, wanted people to vote the budget down for that reason and other reasons. And so hopefully over the next year, the games will stop in East Ramapo now that Manerva and D'Agostino, it seems, will be vanquished.
Well, Peggy, don't forget, the games go on even during the board meeting. At the very beginning of the reorganizational meeting, they couldn't vote for a president because the newly elected board member, Jermaine, the puppet that he is, voted to abstain on voting for a president.
Yeah, you know, he voted to abstain on voting for the president and for the vice president. They had to take a revote. But he did vote, I believe he voted yes, for firing the Manerva and D'Agostino law firm, but then bringing them back to be there through the transition period until they find other counsel. And you know, Tony, you and I were there at 2:30 in the morning on November 8th, I guess it was then November 9th, 2009, when Aaron Weider was asked by Dr. Ausstachers and others on the board if he had a transition plan in place, and he said that there was no transition needed. Funny how there was no transition needed in 2009, but now there's an open-ended contract with Manerva and D'Agostino. So we're going to be keeping a very close eye on what goes on and how long it takes the school district to find alternative legal coverage.
And, you know, it really shouldn't take long. An RFP, a request for proposal, should have been issued that night. And I've checked the district website. There is none up. That's what they did the last time after an appeal was sent in, that they just outright hired D'Agostino, and then they had law firms that submitted proposals, but they hired D'Agostino anyway.
Well, big surprise. Big surprise. Our studio lines are open, so anyone who wants to call in, please feel free. That's 362-0013. Okay.
And I think we might have a call.
We might. Okay, welcome to East Ramapo Underground.
Morning.
Good morning to the East Ramapo Underground.
Good morning. You're on the air.
If you could let people know how they can support you, what they can do to actually assist East Ramapo, and I know we had at least one gentleman at the demonstration who actually had come from Arizona because he felt that this issue is important for the entire nation as far as education and rights for correct education and public school education in the country, as well as how to contact the Bar Association and how to file protests and demand that action be taken against this law firm and the attorneys for their actions.
Okay. Well, I guess one of the first things that I would suggest is that people contact Governor Cuomo, because he is the person who I believe has the power to make something change here in East Ramapo. And in fact, I know that many people have written to the governor, and people have also filed complaints with the 10th District Court. Tony, can we put that up on our website, on our Facebook page?
Yes, I'll put that up later on. And people can always contact us at eastrampounderground@hotmail.com.
Right, or leave us a message on our Facebook page also. You know, the outpouring of support, you're right when you say people came from all over. I was so impressed and honored to see the NAACP president for the NIAC branch, Francis Pratt, came and stood there and held a sign in support of our students and of the parents in East Ramapo. We had people from all over Rockland County. I've never seen that before, and it really was very heartfelt for me to see that people do care about what's happening in East Ramapo, and they do realize that it is going to affect the greater community. So I think those are two of the best ways to make their feelings known. Of course, you can always write to or call the Board of Education. The phone number for the district clerk is 577-6015, or you can send an email to the Board of Education by clicking on the link for the East Ramapo Central School District website. And you can call Dr. Klein, and I believe his number is 577-6011, and register your feelings and complaints with them as well.
And is there any progress into the further investigation of use of public school funds for religious school books, some of which were reportedly purchased in New Square themselves, and then also what's happening with the, what I call theft of public school property with the sale of the yeshiva to the yeshiva of New Square, of the public school that with the property that abuts New Square?
Well, that's an ongoing criminal investigation that's being conducted by the Attorney General. As a matter of fact, this past school board, well, the night that Kirby had his tirade, Aaron Weider requested a different attorney to represent him other than Albert D'Agostino, because it appears that there's a conflict of interest between Mr. D'Agostino and Mr. Weider.
And quite frankly, there's always been a conflict of interest in D'Agostino representing the board, since he was also party to that transaction. And the Attorney General is reviewing his role in the sale of, I believe it was Colton. What, is it Colton or Hillcrest or
Colton,
both, Tony?
Both of them.
Yeah. And so, you know, they actually sued the Attorney General's office to allow Mr. D'Agostino to remain on as their primary legal's counsel. But here's a little interesting factoid, folks. You know, when you talk about theft of money or money being improperly spent, just a couple of weeks ago, the Attorney General's office, well, actually, I guess it was the state of the Office of the Comptroller, limited the amount of money that could be spent on Sheldon Silver, Speaker of the House, what he can spend per hour for his defense in a legal matter, to $500 for legal counsel and $200 for paralegal services. And yet the board members and former board members continue to seek out legal counsel at the extraordinary rate of $650 an hour. That is money that is taken off the table for our kids, and it is an absolute disgrace that we're paying $650 an hour to represent the likes of Aaron Weider. So let me just stop right there.
And the last thing I wanted to ask about is, I know we continually have cuts to the public school and to the public school educations and the public school education programs. I understand that the private schools, and again, because people don't want their children traveling with other children, we have to have these redundancy of services, plus they don't want their children educated with other children. We have the redundancy of services. Is there still an investigation into I don't know if it's special ed or whatever the reason is for the children being shipped up to Kiryas Yol for their education? And also, is it true that there was just in the last year all of these new buses and stuff purchased for the private schools out of the budget? And the last piece of that is, have there ever been any cuts to the private school activities as compared to the massive cutting that's being done to the public schools?
Well, you know, the private school community is entitled to services for special education students, and for regular education students, they are entitled to transportation and books and some other services through the title funds. So, you know, as has been reported in the paper incorrectly, actually on the blogs, the private school community likes to say that Tony and I don't want the private school students to get any services, and that is absurd. They can get whatever they're entitled to get legally. But your question about has there been any non-mandated services offered to the private schools that have been cut, the answer is that they've had a couple of days taken away for non-mandated busing. That means that when East Ramapo schools are closed and their schools are open, East Ramapo does not pay for that transportation. However, that's the only thing that's been cut. In any other school district, if a student needs to have services for special ed like OT or PT or speech or resource room or any of those things, those support services are only offered at the schools. And the child comes either before or after school to the public school setting to receive those services. East Ramapo, years ago, made the deal that if there were more, I think, than five students in a school, they would push those services in and send the therapists and teachers into the school itself so that the students didn't have to come to East Ramapo. That practice still continues, even though they have completely decimated the special education budget for private school students. They've taken
public school students.
They've taken out $1.9 million out of the public school special education fund, but they've taken out $0 for the private school students for their special ed services still being pushed in. And that's a bit of a sore point with me.
What people fail to realize, Dr. Klein has admitted, and the board hasn't refuted it, that even with the 500 cuts that the public schools have endured over the past 4 to 5 years, the budget still goes up, and it's being cost-driven by the non-public schools in regards to busing and the amount of special education services that that community needs.
Mm-hmm. Right. Well, you know, according to Dr. Klein, and I never quite know what to believe when he says what he doesn't say, but that there's 1,000 new students expected to enter into the private school community every year. And so, of course, the costs do go up accordingly with that. And part of the problem, although some people disagree, is that the state aid formula, does not take those costs into effect when they reimburse the district. So there's a formula issue as well. But to answer your question, all of these cuts have been taken out, with the exception of transportation, out on the public school students, and it's very, very sad. Very sad. Do we have another call? We do. We have people lining up. Thank you for your call.
Okay. Good morning to East Ramapo Underground.
Good morning, Tony. Good morning, Peggy.
Good morning.
Hey, Dawn. How are you?
Fine. Listen, I wanted to make a comment. Well, two comments, actually. The fact that, Peggy, you forgot to mention to give a special shout-out to Reverend Weldon McWilliams IV. Due to the fact that he got that demonstration together and did a wonderful job with the demonstration. And I think that we need to give him that support, because he was just wonderful. And you know, I have been screaming and hollering about we needed more participation from the ministers of this area.
Mm-hmm.
And Dr. McWilliams has come out and has really given his all to that.
That's true. Let me just say this. Reverend McWilliams did an outstanding job at getting the protest out ahead of the meeting. But we have to also say that Steve White and Power of 10 was instrumental in getting the message out to people,
as well as
the news organizations also. So
yes.
You're right. He did a terrific job.
Okay. Next, I want to say, I am concerned because what happened to you at the board meeting was despicable. And there are two members of that East Ramapo board who are persons of color, who are supposed to be representing the public schools.
Mm-hmm.
Yet, they sat on the podium and didn't demand that the board president stop Attorney Kirby's rant against you. a public school parent.
You know, you're absolutely right, and I have to say that there's such a tone at the top of allowing the students and the parents of public school community to be disrespectful, and the tone at the top is evident and pervasive. You know, there was a couple of months ago where student Nicholas Palacos said that he was cursed out by attorney Albert D'Agostino and then invited to take the fight out to the parking lot. This was a 17-year-old kid that's 150 pounds, and here he is being challenged by someone in their late 60s to a fight, you know, and weighed double his weight or close to it. So, you know, there were a lot of witnesses back then, including reporter Megan Murphy for Newsday, who wrote a firsthand account of that whole incident. And yet the board refused to take action against the firm, and they said that nothing ever happened.
Yes.
So, you know, there's a tone at the top that really needs to be addressed in East Ramapo.
Yes,
I
understand.
Dr. Klein even said that it was a hoax.
Yeah.
That's right.
Yep. Okay. So, you know, as we can see now, it's not a hoax. It's a continuing, you know, pattern of mistreatment at the hands of the board and the attorneys. And let's just hope that good riddance to Manerva and D'Agostino ASAP.
That's right, and I agree. But I want to continue by saying Mr. Charles and Mr. Germain are not representing the public schools.
Well, I felt that meeting that I wasn't being represented by anybody.
No, we're not.
And my rights were not being protected by anybody that sat on that board, or Dr. Klein, for that matter.
Okay.
I think we have another caller.
No, so I'm not finished.
Well,
okay.
We got to get going because there's people stacking up.
Okay.
30 seconds.
Right.
Finish up.
Hi. Good morning to East Underground. Good morning to East Ramapo Underground.
Hi, how are you?
Hi.
Hi.
Just want to say, Peggy, I'm sorry to hear what went on at the meeting. It's not my district, but it doesn't matter. It wasn't nice what happened. I have a question. In Monroe, they have the Curious Joel, and I know that's a separate, I guess, area. Are they attached to the public school at all? For funding?
No. Well, yes and no. Curious Joel is a public school school district. It's a sort of equivalent to New Square, where it's a confined village, and they have their own school district, and they only serve special education students. I think last year, Tony, am I correct that there were 44 students from East Ramapo that went to KJ?
Yeah.
Okay.
I think so.
And next year, some of those kids will be coming back if the special education plan is approved for a bilingual Yiddish English program here back in the district, and that will hopefully save some money. I haven't heard whether the commissioner approved that plan or not.
Which is only fair. Otherwise, we might do Spanish and languages. You know.
Well, that's just it. And you know, the first time out that they tried to do this, they tried to just integrate a school named Rise into the public schools, and it would have been an all-white special education school, and that fell flat on its face for obvious reasons and civil rights reasons. Now they are planning to do, if it is approved, a couple of classes in bilingual special ed for Creole or French and also Spanish. So we'll see how that goes.
What's good for one is good for the other.
Absolutely. That's all we're asking for, is equal treatment.
Right. Would it be better to have a New Square like a Curious Joel and have them have their own place?
Well, I guess if it was better for them, they would have done it by now. So I guess I don't really know what the story is there. Assemblyman Zabrowski is putting forth a study to see if any, there is possible to address this issue, because it's only going to continue to get worse. The imbalance of public versus private will continue to always go toward the private school community. So we don't know where that's going to go, but that's a great question. Thank you.
I mean, also between voting and social services, and that goes for everybody in the county, I think we should address that situation and see where the money is going. And I also believe in the whole county, I don't know if it's individual, show your identity when you vote. I don't mind showing it.
Well,
all right, have a great
weekend.
Speaking
to the choir there, okay. Do we have another caller? Yes. Welcome to East Ramapo Underground. You're online.
Morning, Peggy and Antonio.
Good morning.
So, I was also at the meeting, and I find it disgusting that they wouldn't just fire them.
Yep.
And you know, that I think they did it, they're doing D'Agostino a favor, because when D'Agostino goes for other positions with other school boards, oh, I did work for the East Ramapo School District. You know what I'm saying? And it won't show that he was fired.
Yeah, but you know what? If you Google Manerva and D'Agostino or D'Agostino or Kirby, there's not one positive thing that pops up there. So I think that, you know, there's been so much coverage, I don't think they can escape the fact of what happened on July 2nd in the parking lot and the harassment that occurred there. So, but what I do have a problem with is that there's no, they didn't say there would be a three-week transition period. They didn't give a period at all, and so they're going
to
continue.
Period. They shouldn't have been allowed. They should have just been fired, hand over all property of ours, and bye bye. You know, we need that. We need a lawyer's help when the school board went for them. Why do we need their help finding another lawyer now?
Yeah, I agree with you, Tony. I were there at 2:30 in the morning when Aaron Weider said we didn't need that transition period.
Yeah, so it's competent school board would have immediately fired them.
It shouldn't have taken a week either, by the way. It should have been the next day. So, thank you. We got lots of calls stacking up. Thanks for calling in. Welcome to the East Ramapo Underground Radio Show. You're on live.
Hi, Peggy and Antonio. Listen, Peggy, everybody else is saying it, but I'm going to say it also. No one should have to go through what you went through. That was completely disgusting. And the only reason he knew he could say such a thing was he knew there would be no, he thought there would be no repercussions. And as far as letting people know that the law firm, is so terrible, I want to tell you that might be an enhancer for clients. I really mean it, because you want a tough lawyer.
No, no one wants a vile, disgusting lawyer that gets up in parents' faces.
Okay, you hope so. But,
no.
I hope so.
There's not another school district in the world that would want that kind of behavior.
Of course not. Of course not. But he knows, they know they could get away with it.
Well, they didn't get away with it, thankfully, because in today's world, we do have video cameras. Unlike poor Nicholas Polakos that didn't have his abuse on video, we did. So, good riddance, Mr. Kirby.
Well, I hope, yes, and the hope, but I hope this enlightens, this is my real point. I hope this enlightens the rest of the county. Everything everyone said prior to me was 100% right.
Right.
Everybody in Rockland County doesn't realize that just because we have it in East Ramapo, it's going to flow everywhere else, and they better get wise. I was at something with people in New City, and let me tell you, I made my feelings and known, and I told them, wake up, because it's spreading.
Yep.
All right? And as far as the marches, we need more marches.
Well, we'll be very active over the summer.
Wonderful.
Thanks for calling in.
Bye.
We got more calls. Thank you. Oh, they hung up. Sorry about that. Is there anyone else there, Steve, or is that it? Okay. All right. So if people want to call in, the number is 362-0013. Okay. What were you going to say, Tony?
You know, it just shows that the school board is leaderless, and the Our Town newspaper did have a review about school boards, and specifically East Ramapo, and how they're leaderless.
That's true.
So people should pick that up on the newsstands, or do like I do. I subscribe, and I pay, the going rate for the Our Town newspaper,
right,
which is free.
And Rockland County Times, let's not forget the Star, Star. They've all covered it. The Journal News has been fantastic. We miss Newsday very much. But we have another caller. Welcome to East Ramapo Underground. You're on the air.
Good morning.
Good morning.
I just want to respond to the transitional time that they need.
Mm-hmm.
Clearly, they need a transitional time. If there have been any things going on that are illegal, like money laundering and theft, mm-hmm, they need time to cover their tracks. They're scrambling right now.
Yeah.
They've been in cahoots.
Well,
millions and millions of dollars are involved here.
Well, let's just say this. They're definitely intertwined, because D'Agostino is the defendant in the federal lawsuit, and he's also being investigated by the Attorney General's office.
This is the time for the state to sweep.
Absolutely.
In,
could not agree
down,
with you more.
Freeze all the records,
right,
and catch them red-handed before they have a time to hide things and cover their trail and launder more money.
Well, we agree with you. Governor Cuomo, where are you? You promised to be the lobbyist for children, and so far you've broken that promise to the East Ramapo school kids.
You don't have to be a genius to figure out why they need transitional time.
Yeah, well, they really can't hide it that much, let me tell you. All right, I think we have another call, Steve, another line. Thank you for calling in.
Hello.
Welcome to East Ramapo Underground.
Hi.
Hi.
Okay, I'm a member of the Orthodox community, but not a member of the Hasidic community. And
uh-huh.
I wanted to ask one question.
Sure.
The only question, and by the way, I think your tone of voice is very, very good, and your control of emotions of people who call is pretty good. Now, the lady who called and said that she was in a new city meeting,
mm-hmm.
and wake up because it's spreading. I would like to know what you think that means.
Okay, well, you know, here's the thing. This is America, and people can live wherever they want to live, and so we can't say that people from the Hasidic community shouldn't live any place. I personally don't think that that's an American value that I endorse. Of course, people can live wherever they want. However, up until these past 5 years, I think we had a pretty harmonious arrangement. The Hasidic community says that they were denied special education services. I don't know whether that's true or not. I can tell you that my kid went to private school, and when he was first being evaluated for special ed, they told me that he was not eligible. And when he came to the public schools, all of a sudden, when it was the public schools' problem to deal with, then he was classified. So there may be some truth to that. But I think that they have really gone overboard in taking control of the school district and then taking monies off the table for the public school children, almost like a vendetta. So I think that there's a terrific imbalance, and I think that this particular school board has really pushed the public school kids off the agenda completely. No one ever asks about them. No one ever asks what the graduation rate is. No, you know, so I think that that's unfair. I think that if we could live together and if we could coexist, then that's one thing. But right now, the way things are, if I was living on the borders of East Ramapo, I would be concerned that the same thing would happen to my school board. And with that happening to the school board, then it also decreases your property values. So we have to be very careful. You know, we don't want, there was a time when, you know, no one wanted to have black people living next to them, or the Irish living next to them, or the Italians. Every newcomer to the United States of America has suffered under those discrimination tactics. I don't endorse that. However, we cannot just close a blind eye and say that what's happening in East Ramapo cannot happen elsewhere, because quite frankly, I think it will. What do you think about that?
I'm not as familiar with all the machinations of the school board,
yeah,
vice versa. I think that the Hasidic community probably does have a problem of needing a lot more special ed for one reason or another, and maybe because of the way in which the marriages.
No, but you know what?
Arranged.
That's not true either. Let me. Just,
I mean, I don't know if it's true or not.
Let me just tell you. I don't think that there's. I don't think that that really kind of does hurt my heart. Being a special education mom, I don't think that the Hasidic community has any more higher numbers of special education students than the general population.
Okay.
I don't agree with that. But
okay.
But I do think that the way that they've gone about the governance of our school district is reprehensible. I will say that loud and clear. And if I was any other school district, I'd be very concerned. We have phone lines stacking up, but good question. Thank you for calling in,
Thank
sir.
Thank you for calling.
Okay, bye-bye.
Okay, welcome to East Ramapo Underground. You're on the air.
Hi. Pat.
Peggy.
Peggy. I think the problem is not that we don't want to live next to the Hasidics, but that they do not want to live next to us. When they move into an area, they change the area, they become exclusive, they will not let non-Hasidics buy property in, quote, their area. they build houses like they're building next to the Spring Valley Post Office.
Right.
That they only advertise to Hasidics.
Well, that's a big problem.
And that's the problem.
That's
it's not
a
that
huge
we don't want to live next to them. They don't want to live next to us. So when they do move into an area, they almost throw us out and tell us we're not welcome. You
right.
can go shopping in their stores, as
right.
you saw happen a couple of weeks ago.
Right.
And, you know, when we say that it's spreading, what we mean is the threat to the school board's a threat.
Well,
spreading.
Absolutely.
Because I don't want New City to have happen to what happened to East Ramapo.
Right. And
that's the problem. I'm not talking in terms of people. I'm talking in terms of taking over a school board
right.
and then gaming the system.
Right. No, we hey, listen, we're living it, so we
oh,
got
yeah.
that. You know, I just want to say, too, this past week, there was another parcel of land that was zoned for, I believe, one house per acre or mm-hmm. one house per half acre on Viola Road.
Yeah, across from the high school.
Yes, across from the high school. And this is why I continue to blame Christopher St. Lawrence for the downfall of East Ramapo
yeah.
School District, because that came before him and his rubber stamp board this
mm-hmm.
week. And I've been asking, does anybody on that board ever ask how that's going to impact the East Ramapo School District?
Well,
and I can tell the answer is no.
There.
Right. The answer is no.
I say 44 families. They're going to put
44 times how many kids?
For people who do not pay taxes or pay low taxes because
they do pay taxes
and services.
They do pay taxes. We can't make a blanket statement
that
either.
Yeah, make that statement.
It depends on where they are. You
yeah.
know, whether they can take off one room from their houses being a house of worship or whatever.
Okay.
But I'm not even going to get into that. We have an overabundance of tax exempt
yes.
properties in East Ramapo, but they completely. Over and over and over again at every opportunity, St.
Okay.
Lawrence allows the downzoning to continue in
mm-hmm.
Eastern Ramapo, and it is destroying our school district and eroding our tax base.
Okay, in terms of taxes, there's something else. If you look at the census figures, you see that the average income, as reported by the U.S. Census Bureau, for Muncie, New Square, that is about $10,000 to $15,000 a year.
Right.
Because that's what shows. You know,
right.
$15,000 a year. So if you're paying taxes on $15,000, and I don't know what the actual income is, because there's no way you can raise 10 kids on $15,000 a year. But the point is, so don't say they're paying their fair share of taxes, because I know they must have a higher income than that.
I didn't say fair share, but okay.
They are paying taxes, but the point
right.
is they hide
money. You just have
money.
To be careful.
If the money is hidden,
that's
not
right.
shown.
Let me tell you something. I've never been able to afford someone to come clean my house one day of my life, and
exactly.
we don't make $14,000 a year.
Right.
So your point well taken. The phones are sacking. Thank you for calling in. No, next. Okay. Welcome to East Ramapo Underground. You're on the air.
Good morning, Peggy. Good morning, Tony.
Good morning.
Hey, good
First
morning.
First of all, I feel sorry what happened to you at the meeting.
Thank you.
And then I have two questions for Tony, and I'll be happy to hang up and listen for the answer.
Okay, okay, sure.
Number one, if you can tell me who is, what if there's any connection between Preserve Ramapo, Wake Up Rockland, because I'm kind of confused who is Preserve Ramapo, who is Wake Up Rockland, and who is Tony. And then
who
the second
Tony?
Question is, where was Tony by the demonstration this week? I didn't see him there.
Oh, you didn't hear the beginning? He's on
I'm
special assignment trying to find Mara Luz Corrado. So that's why he wasn't at that demonstration. I don't know. Tony, you want to take the other question, or should I jump in here?
No, about the different organizations?
Mm-hmm.
Wake Up
Rockland. Wherever I go, I see Tony. Is it Wake Up Rockland? Is there a Ramapo or any demonstration, East Ramapo Underground? So I'm kind of confused who is leading which
okay.
organization.
Okay, East Ramapo Underground is Peggy and my show. I foot the bill entirely out of my own pocket, and I have. You know, so to say otherwise is wrong. Wake Up Rockland is an umbrella group comprised of many different groups. And really the question of who belongs to Wake Up Rockland, you'd have to ask Dr. McWilliams.
And you're invited. Call up Dr.
Invited.
Facebook him, and I'm sure you'll be invited to the next rally.
Yeah.
So, you know who's Preserve Rockland? Is the same group of Preserve Ramapo?
I think that Preserve Rockland is it's an extension of Preserve Ramapo because they are now endorsing candidates outside of Ramapo, like Ed Day.
I saw all of the candidates that were running now for election was by the demonstration this week. So it seems to me that only these candidates care for East Ramapo. Why are they running on Preserve Ramapo's line?
I'm not quite sure I understand your question there.
All of the candidates that run for election or for re-election was there this week with a demonstration. So I'm just asking, why are they running on Preserve Ramapo's line? I think they should be running on the regular line or in the...
Well, they are, but they are. Ed Day is running on the Republican line. He's running on Preserve Rockland line, and there were other people from the community. David Freed was at the demonstration, and he is a Democrat who will be primaried. There was Ellen's Jaffe, Ken Zabrowski, Carlucci was not there, but he sent someone from his office. Tony Earle was there. He certainly is not a great friend of East Ramapo School District, because we've called him out as a zero a couple of times. So there were people from all walks of life at that particular event, and we welcome you to join us. Can I tell you that I had women from New Square call me at home personally and apologize for the treatment that I received, because they said that as women they want to stand by me. I also had rabbis Facebook me and call my house and also apologize. So, I just want to say, and I said it that night at the rally, there are good people and bad people in all walks of life, whether you're Christian, Muslim, Jewish, whatever. And it just so happens that I think the people who are on the school board right now, I will take out Mr. Rothman, because he's a stand-up guy. He's never walked out on anybody, and he did stand up for us that night in the parking lot. The new guy, he just was elected, appointed, I should say, to the seat, so I have no opinion on him. But the rest of them, whether they're black, white, whatever, it doesn't matter. Just do the right thing. Yeah. So
I think we have another call.
We have another caller. Thank you for calling in.
Late.
And we're coming to the top of the hour, too, so this has got to be short. Welcome to East Ramapo Underground. You're on the air. Hello?
Hi, I'm on the air right now.
Yes, you are.
Oh, okay. I wanted to ask a question in regards to Israel Bear.
Yes.
He is, from my understanding, he's the treasurer of East Ramapo School Board, as well as the member of the zoning board. And it just seems like that's a lot of control for one person to have.
Mm-hmm.
I didn't know if there was anything that could possibly...
Well, you know what? Moshe Hopstein is on one of the boards in Spring Valley, and Eli Solomon is on another board in Spring Valley. Mr. Lefkowitz is also on the town of either zoning or planning board. So they all are, they're all, burning the candle at both ends, and I think it is very unfair. I agree with you. I don't think that you should be able to make zoning decisions and then that hurts the school district, and then vote on school district funds and how they'll be dispensed. So, and closing of schools and selling of properties, I think that it is a conflict of interest.
Oh, totally a conflict of interest, and it's a monopoly of the public.
Yep, we totally agree with you.
So, I mean, just so listeners know that there's a lot of things that people really need to pay attention to.
Yep.
Moving forward.
Absolutely. Thanks for the call. Do we have another call?
Thank you.
Oh, no more calls. Okay. All right.
Wow.
That was a quick, we're almost at the top of the hour. That was very quick. I think, Tony, can you just talk for a moment about what happened with the $9 million worth of transfers? Because that sort of got lost in the shuffle with all of the media blitz.
And we're going to have to do it really quick.
Go ahead.
The board shuffled. Well, Israel Beer made transfers within the budget that were not approved by the board for $7.7
million.
Million dollars,
folks.
And 2 years ago, Nathan Rothschild went crazy with $2 million. So now, he wants to do an additional $9 million of transfers, and it's really not even board approved, but they'll find out what he's done after he's done it.
But they were also held hostage because Mr. Bear said that unless they approved all the millions of dollars of transfers, they wouldn't have made payroll.
Right, exactly. And the school district would financially shut down. And we are coming really to the top of the hour, Peggy, so I want to thank everybody for calling in.
And you make sure that you keep on your search for Mariluz Corrado.
I'm still on the hunt.
Okay.
WRCR Spring Valley, it's 11 o'clock.